I think we can proceed perhaps to the next talk, which is going to be given by Dr. Pedoya from UCSF, and it's going to be on MSK image segmentation. Thank you.
Okay, so you guys should be able to see my screen properly. And yes. Thank you for the introduction and thank you for the invitation to talk today. I was asked to talk about musculoskeletal MRI segmentation, and I have nothing to disclose related to this specific context of this talk. So the image processing pipeline in musculoskeletal MRI often include a segmentation step. So often one of the first step that you do when you do your whole pipeline to extract musculoskeletal biomarkers from MRI images. There are several techniques. Some of the mostly used ones are either graph-based or atlas and registration-based, and more recently, machine learning and deep learning-based algorithm. This is a review paper. It's from 2020, and is a nice overview of the landscape of the segmentation in musculoskeletal imaging. This is particularly focused on cavalage segmentation on MRI, and in this graph here, in this graph here, you can see different methods that are classified by types, and they are all compared based on the number of images that were used to test the algorithm and the dice coefficient, which is a metric for the overlap between the manual and the automatic segmentation. As you see in this graph, there was at that point this review look at papers that are until 2018, pretty much. So the landscape of the different algorithms was very diverse, and we had entry, and the distribution of dice coefficient was very high. So some of the methods they were working much better than other, and the sample size was not very high. So the number of samples that were used for testing, it was pretty much narrow, in around 100-200 range. We don't have here an overwhelming method that is overwhelming better than others. So that is where we were in 2018. This is a PubMed research that I did yesterday, and this is not just in musculoskeletal imaging; it's general in medical imaging. But the trend is exactly the same for musculoskeletal imaging. So this review was sitting pretty much here, and in this graph we are seeing just how overwhelming is the usage of deep learning for musculoskeletal imaging segmentation, for medical imaging segmentation. But this is true for musculoskeletal as well. This is probably thanks to one big revolution in segmentation, which is the presentation in 2015 at a challenge that we just stopped talking about. That this is one of those cases in which a challenge was a boosting for advancing that specific field that was microscopic imaging, but generally the field of segmentation. So the UNAC model was presented, and this was a revolution, because it's a fully convolutional model for segmentation. So the idea on how the segmentation was performed using machine learning is completely different than everything that was done before. So before, if you wanted to use machine learning for segmentation, you would define your problem as a classification problem, and probably with a sliding window into your image, you want to probably classify the central voxel or central pixel of your image using a classifier. So in this case, the model is 100% end-to-end. So you have a full image in input and a full image in output. It has an encoding and a decoding path. And the encoding path, you have a representation, and then you can reconstruct into a full dense segmentation mask. After a couple of years, probably a year or some, there was additional changing over the initial UNET. UNET model, VNet, it's, for example, the It's not just a 3D version of a VNet, of a UNet, but is has some very interesting implementation trick for which, instead of doing downsampling with pooling that need the storing of all the indexes, is that it does padded convolution. So the upsampling does not need to have all the indexes stored. So you can have a much light model. So you have a reduced memory footprint, which seems like a very detail in terms of implementation detail, but when you want to go 3D, this is basically the bottleneck of the application of 3D models on the entire volume. So if I say it like that, seems like a implementational trick, but it was actually a very good game changing in terms of using encoder decoder model like a UNet on 3D volumes. Those two models are very difficult to beat. Today, the Decathlon challenge at Nikkei a couple of years ago was won by a model that is called a not new UNet, so an implementation of a UNet with some heuristics over the pre-processing pipeline. And so from a matter of algorithm perspective, it's very difficult to come out with something that can beat those two models in a general purpose manner. So you can have something that overfit your specific problem, but an algorithm that can be general purpose is very difficult to be invented at this point. So if you think it like that, it looks like we are done with segmentation. We can use a UNet to do everything that we want to do. But if we take a look at the life cycle of generally healthcare technology and segmentation in musculoskeletal imaging and in general, pretty much it's the same cycle. So there is a initial phase, I call it preclinical. This has nothing to do with animal, but it's the way I think the initial phases of a development. You are working on harmonized data set, maybe coming from a challenge that is well curated. You have a large amount of annotation and you work most likely on a single sequence. You work most likely on a single vendor. So we are at that stage that in this particular condition, when we are under optimal conditions, we know how to do it. If you have enough data, you probably can train one of those two models and you will obtain reasonable results for most of the problem in musculoskeletal imaging. There is a second phase that is more what I call clinical, in which you want to go outside of your lab environment and you want to start testing your model. And in this case, you will work with probably less curated data, maybe with weak annotations. You want to work under a condition in which you want to test your model with an external validation, maybe that come from another sequence, and maybe that come from a different vendor. We are in the process of this phase. We are not done with this specific space. So we don't have models that can generalize that easily on those conditions that are still controlled, because it's not like inferring into the wild, but they are a little bit outside the preclinical super control condition that you have before. There is another step in which you want to work on a clinical data set completely uncontrolled. You want your model to always be robust to everything that comes to it. And most importantly, you will need to have your model, your segmentation model or your segmentation algorithm to be robust, to live within a pipeline of other technologies. So your model will need to be robust to parallel imaging, to compress sensing, to everything that comes into the pipeline. So it's very possible that your image will come to you not completely optimized, just because it will be part of a longer pipeline in the overall life cycle of an image acquisition reconstruction and processing. And we are not there yet. This is something that the community is working on, but we are just moving the first step in integration of different problems in medical imaging, as for example, MRI reconstruction and MRI segmentation. So I'll give some example on all of these phases. So what I call preclinical phases in the musculoskeletal community, we have several large data set. One is the Osteoarthritis Initiative, which is a data set with 5,000 osteoarthritis subjects followed up for 8 years, and MRI was scanned in most of the visits for both knee. So this is an enormous data set of well-curated data. There is one sequence is a high-resolution 3D DES. So those are all Siemens magnet in image. And for this image, we have solution. As I said, this is a very control environment. The Osteoarthritis Initiative provide some manual segmentation on a subset of those images, and some of the stats on how many is appear in this table. And in this case, we train ensemble of VNets, and we can obtain results that are very high and comparable with intrapersonal variability. So it really looks like that we know how to do it. We know how to do it exactly as a human will do. We wanted to understand what is the overall state of the art of segmentation. In 2019, the International Workshop of Osteoarthritis Imaging organized a segmentation challenge using this Osteoarthritis Initiative data set that I just presented. And there was a timeline with team registration and 6 teams. This is a much niche situation than what you will imagine in a MIKAI challenge, but 6 teams, which is basically all the people working on musculoskeletal knee segmentation, participated from 10 different institutes. The model were all deep learning based, but there was very variety in terms of architecture and training strategy. There was a shared test set that none of the team had in advance, and all the model were evaluated using DICE score and coverage thickness as a biomarker, as an endpoint clinical biomarker. So those are some qualitative example. They all think went really well. So all the teams submitted a very competitive solution, and those are some of the. It's one example, three different examples for all the different team, and this is an ensemble of all the team together. And this KLG is KL grading, which is a grading for osteoarthritis severity. So it goes from a lower osteoarthritis to severe osteoarthritis. So you see here there is a total loss of cartilage, and all the models were pretty robust in different situations. If we look at the quantitative analysis, it was difficult to identify a winner because there were no significant differences in DICE in the different compartment in all the first four team. And similarly for coverage thickness. So this graph here is instead the analysis of coverage thickness error, and consider that the resolution of this image is at 0.4 in plane and 0.7 out of plane. So if you make a error that is in average half of the resolution, it is probably the best that you can do with those images in terms of extracting coverage thickness. So this is very important that we end up analyzing also the coverage thickness, which as we said in the previous talk, it's always important to keep in mind the clinical endpoint and where we are going, what we are doing this segmentation for. The fact that the coverage thickness was we will end up analyzing also coverage thickness was not disclosed with the they could imagine, but it was not disclosed with the participants, so we could not overfit over this particular clinical outcome. What did we do at UCSF for as a participation to this challenge? We end up not deciding to develop a new architecture, but rather to use several version, 2D and 3D, and more shallow, more deep of the same VNet model, and ensemble different solutions. It was a pretty good choice, because we were able to have the results of the model ensembling, which is the average of the logits of the probability of all the model, being always better than any of the single model. So, and there was not one of the model that was better than the other in all the cases. So in some cases the 2D model was better than the 3D, in some cases the more shallow model was better than the deeper. So the ensembling helped us to have a robust solution over the entire data set. Going to the second step, when we try to go more on clinical cases, and even more difficult problem in terms of segmentation. This is an example of a study looking at spine segmentation, but trying to do it in a more uncontrolled manner and with a smaller data set. So it's wonderful that we have this model for segmentation, but it's not really practical if you say, yes, I have an algorithm for automatic segmentation, but you just need to segment 100 cases manually before we can get started. So that means I don't have an algorithm for automatic segmentation, because the sample size of the studies in several situations are smaller than the number of cases that you will need for a training of those models. So we try to do it in a more controlled way. We just randomly selected from a clinical acquired scan at UCSF between 2008 and 2018. So also a large spread in terms of time. So the technology in terms of MRI changed drastically in those 10 years. And we selected a smallish sample for three different task of vertebral body segmentation, intravertebral disc segmentation, and muscle for the spine. And we have some inclusion and exclusion criteria, but pretty much we take everything that comes from the scanner. And those are the results. Which are pretty encouraging, considering that this is a more uncontrolled situation, still lab setting, because we had inclusion exclusion criteria. We had some quality control of the images, if the image was completely dark or any problem, metal artifact or anything like that, they were not included, but still they are clinical sequence. The DICE coefficient is comparable with the intrapersonal variability here, but one thing that was interesting for us to see is that this is up is the manual segmentation, this is automatic segmentation specifically for the spine, or all the anatomy that will be repeated outside of your field of view. It was difficult to convince the model that was trained from L1 to S1, and in this case, this particular case has a higher field of view, so the last thoracic vertebra was also included, which makes the model segment also the last thoracic, because it was trained to segment vertebra and it was segmenting all the vertebra. This will be negative weights in your DICE evaluation, but I'm not 100% sure that you can call this one an error. And here in which other way around, in which the last disc is not completely included in the field of view, so the model decided not to include it when the person doing the annotation decided to include it. So this is again on the variability on the annotation. Maybe the next user will not include this one in the manual segmentation, as they were instructed. If the disc is not completely included in the field of view, you will not segment it. But this is a borderline situation and is really a user choice. So this is to emphasize again how important is the ground truth in the in those analysis. And this is my last chapter. So in transit, we want to translate those models, those segmentation models. We will need those segmentation models to live together with the other technology. The first that come to mind is accelerated MRI acquisition. We can develop very high quality segmentation models that work with super high resolution images. But if those images take 10 minutes to be acquired, our segmentation will never translate to clinic anyway, because it's not justifiable to acquire images that are too long and it's too much for border in the scan time. So those segmentation models, they will need to live together with model that with other algorithm that accelerate the acquisition. Most of the acceleration method, they are designed to obtain an image that is as much as possible resembling of the image that could be acquired under optimal condition. So the matrix that are typically used are structural similarity and mean square error. So we are looking at the image quality on the acquisition. However, if we have a model that is able to process this image automatically, maybe we can even have an end-to-end model and actually optimize an overall chain of post-processing in terms of optimizing each post-processing step separately. So this is what we call task-based reconstruction. And we develop a model to do exactly what I said. So to take an image that is acquired, that is accelerated. So it's acquired 8-pair, 10-pair acceleration, and train a model that simultaneously is able to do MRI reconstruction and segmentation of the same image, starting from a noisy version of the image that was acquired under suboptimal condition. And this model has both a loss that consider both reconstruction or segmentation, but is end up being optimized for the final task. And this is why I call it task-based reconstruction. So this is an example of our results. These are preliminary results. And in this example, we can see that even if we acquire a very small percentage of the case space, since the model has to do a job that is much easier than actual MRI reconstruction, because the sparsity of the segmentation is much higher. So we are actually able to segment an image with very high DICE score, even if we start with an imaging input that has that is completely noisy, and the model is way less picky than a human in doing segmentation, and together with the segmentation, the noise will happen intrinsically. So we end up having a very high quality, even if the acquisition is really degraded by the acceleration, which is in this case it's 24 pair acceleration factor, which is out of anything that is actually translated right now. So this is absolutely in phase of development. We compared this solution with several other solutions. The first thing that come to mind: do you really need to have a simultaneous reconstruction and segmentation? You cannot just reconstruct your image and then segment it, and maybe train it end to end with two different model, or can you just use compress sensing or any other reconstruction model, and then when the image will look good, you can segment the image that you reconstruct. So those are some quantitative results, of course all the deep learning model they can work much better when we go at super high acceleration. So this part of the graph is what we call ultra fast, and the compress sensing meter. This is a typo. So this is compress sensing meter. Compress sensing meter does not have any memory or any learning. So it actually restart the iterative process at each image, and when the image is too much degraded, there is nothing that really can be done. The deep learning model have strong a priori, so they can always reconstruct at least an image that look like a knee, which is why Which is why all the deep learning model works much better at ultra high acceleration factor. If we look at the deep learning model, the proposed TB Recon has a actually higher dice coefficient at all the acceleration factor compared with all the other solution in reconstructing and segmenting with two different phases. So it seems that there is an advantage in solving the problem of reconstruction and segmentation as a unique challenge. So where we are with the healthcare technology lifetime for segmentation life cycle. So we definitely have a lot to do to translate those techniques to clinic, and the path is really tortuous, but I think we are in the right path. And definitely what is done and what the community is doing for open science and reproducible MRI research is the key in making this path a little bit less tortuous and getting out from the maze. So that is all I have. Thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to take any questions.